Some 90 years ago, humans didn't know what these things looked like, and then for half a century it was argued whether they were alive or not. They are tens of thousands of times smaller than a needle, but they can put a person in the hospital in a few days. Viruses. What are they made of, and what are they doing in the land of the living? The coolest thing about viruses is that they are very simple. Their whole essence can roughly be divided into two parts. One of them is the protein shell, which protects the virus from the environment and helps infect cells, which is called a capsid. Also, some viruses have got a supercapsid, an additional layer of protection made of lipin, protein, or carbohydrate structures. Inside the capsid is a set of genes that stores the information about the life activity of the virus. This is its genome. All important instructions are kept here: how to propagate the genome, how to regulate and start the process of cell infection, how to build capsids for new viruses. Long story short, a virus is like an eternal wanderer. It is always ready to pack. It carries only the essential things that will help it break into someone else's house, settle in, and start dividing. Viruses are extremely diverse in nature. You know that your hereditary information is recorded in double-stranded DNA, but such monotony is boring for viruses. Their information can be encoded in single-stranded and double-stranded DNA, and even in RNA. In 1971, David Baltimore created a classification where he ordered viruses according to the type of their genome. There were seven such classes in total. And for example, the well-known human immunodeficiency virus, also known as HIV, which according to official data infected about 38 million people around the world, belongs to Baltimore's sixth class. These viruses have got a single-stranded RNA that is located inside of their capsid. Look carefully. Which part of this typology you might recognize? Oh, here it is, a family of those same viruses that stopped the planet in 2020. And there is another your old buddy, and a buddy of all your snotty friends. The fourth class includes rhinoviruses that can cause nasopharyngitis, or in other words, the common cold. You can give it a piece of your mind for your fever, runny nose, and sore throat. But in fact, not only rhinoviruses are responsible for such symptoms. According to various estimates, they are responsible for 30 to 50% of the cases. Adenoviruses, orthomyoxiviruses, whose typical representative is the influenza virus, and others, even bacteria, may be the cause. Therefore, due to the wide variety of those responsible for our snot, it's impossible to create one universal pill or cold vaccine so that you never get sick. For example, even the flu virus is too common a name, and to talk about a certain type of virus, you need to specify its strain. For example, the H1N1 influenza strain is a subspecies of the influenza A virus, which is part of the genus of the same name, which is part of the orthomyoxivirus family, which is part of the articulavirals order. Class Instinthovir... Well, you know, that word. And as you can see, each step up increases the amount of the types of viruses by dozens, if not hundreds of times. So, there is no universal vaccine for all the bad things, and there cannot be one. And those who watched the last video about how horned rabbits told people about the papillomavirus, which causes both harmless warts and rather nasty cancerous tumors, are already aware that there can be a whole bunch of strains, sometimes more than 100. The next curious thing is that all these troubles in the form of cancer, AIDS, hepatitis are caused by viruses that are merely 20 to 400 nanometers in size. A tip of the needle can accommodate tens of thousands of different such samples. Forget the needle, 10 viruses can fit in one bacterium. The size, indeed, does not matter in this case. And yes, there are viruses that only infect bacteria. They are called bacteriophages. Translated from Greek, it means devouring bacteria. Only, in fact, they do not devour anything. On your screen, you can see a representative of the order chordavirals, or tailed viruses. It resembles a molecular syringe. When a virus binds to a bacterium, it literally injects its genome, double-stranded DNA, into the cell and leaves its protein coat outside. The instructions of the bacteriophage become mixed with the instructions of the infected cell, and its usual life activity ceases. The cell begins to use its resources to produce new genomes and proteins of the virus. This stage is called replication. The cell wears and tears, spending all its resources to produce as many viruses as possible. The final stage, lysis, is approaching. New viruses fill the entire space. The host cell breaks, and a new portion of the virus enters the environment. But cell lysis may not occur immediately. A cell can trigger its division, which doubles the virus as well. In such cases, the viral genome is called a provirus, or in case of bacteriophages, prophages. All of this acts like a time bomb that might trigger the activation of viruses in host cells at some point. HIV doesn't break the cell at all. The initial stages are the same: attachment, infection, reproduction of viruses. But lysis of the cell does not occur, and the produced viruses simply bud off from their creator and step on an evil path, while the infected cell continues to produce new samples. It is amazing that during all these infections, there is real chaos taking place in the gene world. Viruses integrate their genome into a host cell. That is their nature. And this can lead to a variety of consequences. The virus can embed itself quietly and remain inactive for a long time. In addition to the usual infection, it can mutate and acquire characteristics useful for survival. And, suddenly, those useful traits can be borrowed from viruses by other organisms. Just as bacteria can grow stronger because of the virus, so can viruses. This rule applies to people as well. Humans have been living on Earth for a long time. Not as long as viruses, of course, but we simply could not have dodged a rendezvous with the little buggers. And traces of those cases are settled in our genes. The viral sequences of retroviruses make up 8% of human DNA. It is believed that these are sleeping genes, which in rare cases can wake up and cause cancer. But sometimes it is not the mafia that wakes up, but the police. Relatively recently, it turned out that many viral proteins from an ancient virus can be found in the cells of a 3-day-old embryo. Viral protein raises the level of another protein, whose task is to sit on the surface of the cell and prevent other viral infections from entering it. It turned out that the resident virus protected embryo's cells from its own kind. Real life takes place at the microscopic level. But can we call a virus a living thing? According to the canonical definition, a virus is an infectious agent, typically consisting of a nucleic acid molecule dressed in a protein coat. And here are the kingdoms of living organisms: archaea, eukaryotes, and even bacteria. If you were wondering, you are somewhere around here, but there are no viruses here. Behind the question of what a virus is, there is a larger one. What is life itself? Bring the list of life traits up on the screen, please. Independent conversion of substances into new genes and protein. The ability to grow. The ability to excrete decay products. Multiplication by division. Blanks everywhere. In 1967, the microbiologist André Luoff stated that a living organism is made up of cells, but a virus doesn't have cells. So, in 2000, the International Commission on the Taxonomy of Viruses announced that viruses are not living organisms. Michael Cordingley, a virologist and author of Viruses, Agents of the Evolutionary Invention, puts forward an even more interesting wording. They are egotistical, independently evolving infectious information. So, in this case, we no longer need to define a living or non-living organism. Viruses are simply pure information, the purpose of which is to use the resources of someone else's system to increase the amount of initial information. It is a little unusual for our nervous system that there is information in the world that affects people's lives. We are used to the fact that a stone is not alive, but a dog is. And then they tell you that somewhere on the nanoscale there is roaming information that can affect you, a massive human being. And if you try to place viruses on the map of the kingdoms of living organisms, it will look something like this. A little creepy, but extremely exciting. Humans got to know viruses only recently. The word itself was used for the first time around 100 years ago, and it was possible to see the virus only thanks to the electron microscope invented in the middle of the last century. So, who knows what discoveries lie ahead? And these are not always bad discoveries, such as a virus that protects the human fetus from other infections, or the fact that viruses can be used in genetic engineering, again, to benefit mankind. What's your opinion on this? And I'm Bonyright.